I really had a gut feeling when I saw her the last time that, is this the last time, you know, I'm going to see her?
I begged for help. I begged for help for hours. I screamed, I cried, and I was just chucked back in the bed, told shut up.
You'd have to say that after 18 presentations, someone would have thought to refer her to an expert, and that just didn't happen.
I think the inquest will have a big impact on this community because it is this group of Aboriginal people standing up and saying, please explain.
In the first few minutes of 2016, when most people were celebrating, 27-year-old Wiradjuri woman Naomi Williams was driving herself to hospital. She was 6 months pregnant. This was her 18th visit to the hospital in just 8 months.
So what do you think was going through their heads when she turned up to emergency on that last night?
Probably thinking, oh, here she comes again.
She was given 2 Panadol and monitored for just over half an hour, then sent home. 15 hours later, she was dead.
That morning was quite hard. Call out to me if you need to go somewhere, do something like that. That's when I actually heard her collapse in the hallway. She lost her body functions. So I got her to the shower to bring her temperature down that. Started getting it down a bit and then we got her to the lounge. That's when she said, told me she couldn't feel her legs.
She rang me then on the 1st around mid-morning. She sounded very different. She was short of breath. She was crying. I was in a panic. It was like, I need to go. I was running around everywhere.
When I got to Naomi's house, it looked like she was going into a fit. We started CPR on her and my father called the ambulance and we just kept going until the ambulance got there.
Talia rang me and said, you need to come. And I said, can you just let her know that we love her and we're thinking of her and we're coming, you know? I wanted to know that we love her. So Talia was, you know, telling her that, but she couldn't talk.
We waited and waited and then finally the doctor came out and told us that she had passed.
Well, no one should have to bury their child. I thought I'd be gone long before her. Some good will come from this anyway. Sorry.
A coronial inquest is trying to find out why this happened, and the answer could change how Indigenous people and their health are treated.
It'll be a big day today, like, because the three of us have to give our evidence, so I expect today will be a really hard day.
What do you hope the court understands from what was heard today?
I hope they understood that Naomi wasn't getting the care she should have.
I just hope no one ever has to go through it again. I've lost 2 people. And yeah, so the outcome, I really hope that it's all good.
Australia Day 2011, yeah, we got together and that. And oh, she was very bubbly. Like, yeah, that's why I think that's what drew me into her. When I met Naomi, she showed me the person I wanted to be.
She was very outgoing, loud, knew everybody.
I've known Naomi my whole life. We were born close together and grew up together. We caused a bit of trouble. We were always sort of the troublemakers.
We were sitting at the kitchen table there one day and their old uncle was there and he busted out laughing. We said, what's wrong? He said, the dog just ran past there and it's blue. We went out and they'd painted him blue. Poor dog.
I think we only would have been about 5 or 6. Yeah.
In 2015, Naomi was a disability support worker living in Tumut.
She loved that job, loved being, like, knowing that she was helping people.
She's always been into social justice issues. You can't judge people based on, you know, their circumstances. Like, anyone that walks through that door gets the same service. You know, she had that always in her mind. Even when she did feel like crap, she'd still go to work.
Naomi started getting sick early in the year. She was nauseous, vomiting and in pain. Her family says she was an occasional marijuana smoker. And as her nausea and stomach pain continued, she turned to that for pain relief. After multiple tests and scans, the hospital was unable to give her a clear diagnosis, but they repeatedly referred her to drug and alcohol counselling.
She'd say, I don't want to go up there. They treat me like a junkie and just that they didn't want to take care of her.
I think racism definitely played a part in it.
When Naomi was finally assessed by that drug and alcohol service, they found she was not an addict, but the hospital staff continued to put her symptoms down to marijuana withdrawal. Her mother, Sharon, based 2 hours away in Canberra, was becoming increasingly frustrated.
Thank you for your email. I've investigated your concerns and request. I'm unable to disclose any details. Many teams become involved in the care to ensure world-class care is given to all patients.
So how did you feel when you read that line about world-class care?
I thought, well, I think she's hearing my concerns and she might actually do something about it. Yeah, but that wasn't the case.
By September, even though her symptoms were the same, her situation wasn't. She was pregnant.
She was just looking forward to having the baby. It was her first baby. She was getting everything prepared.
It was greatest news that she was pregnant. Like, I knew she was the one for me.
She was also given a new diagnosis, hyperemesis gravidarum, a form of extreme morning sickness.
She was all sunken in the face. She was really dark under here. She lost more weight. She skin was sort of flabby, hanging off her. She looked terrible.
She decided to visit her mum in Canberra with plans to move there in the new year to have the baby.
She'd had enough, so we said, I'll come over. We took her to emergency. She'd felt the best she'd felt in ages after a night in hospital over there. She had a good yarn to the doctor. She went out to the Aboriginal Medical Service, and I really had a gut feeling when I saw her the last time that something was not right. I think she was already, you know, on her way.
On that fateful New Year's Eve, Naomi couldn't find anyone to drive her to hospital.
She was quite ill again, just constant vomiting.
You wouldn't be able to get me to the hospital, would you? I can barely move. Just my body aching all over. All good, I'll get there.
Just after midnight, Naomi arrives to emergency on her own. Hospital records state that Naomi was attended by two nurses who noted she had general aches and pains and had not vomited since yesterday. One nurse took her vitals at 12:20 a.m. Four were bordering on the yellow zone, an early warning sign of deterioration. They gave her two Panadol and then retook some, but not all, of her vital signs 15 minutes later. When they fell within normal limits, she was sent home. From the time she walked in to the time she left, 34 minutes had passed. There were no other patients in emergency. 15 hours later, she was dead.
Naomi was only seen for around half an hour that night, the night before she passed the next morning. Do you think that they did enough that night?
No, they didn't. And again, they admitted that they didn't. And why didn't they?
The standard maternity observation chart has a section that requires a pain assessment. She's complaining of pain and yet no pain assessment was done.
Tumut Hospital is small. For Naomi to see a doctor that night, the nurses would have had to phone and ask them to come in. Nurses later told the inquest that the fact it was New Year's did not influence their decision not to call. They also stated that Naomi looked well, was blossoming with pregnancy, and had actually thanked them when she left.
You'd have to say that after 18 presentations, someone would have thought to refer her to an expert, and that just didn't happen.
An autopsy report later revealed that the cause of death was unrelated to Naomi's ongoing vomiting and nausea issues. She had sepsis associated with the bacterium Neisseria meningitidis, a serious infection, but one that is treatable with antibiotics if caught early. However, one of the nurses that treated Naomi that night had not done the necessary training to identify sepsis in pregnant women. Both nurses were also missing a vital piece of information. Naomi was a high-risk patient. Her doctor should have written it in her file.
That could have changed the way she was assessed when she came in on the final occasion. I think the lack of trust that had developed between Naomi and hospital staff may have impacted on her decision not to return to the hospital in the hours before she died.
That's hard to explain, really. Like, it's just everything was taken from me. Like, my future, what we'd planned and everything was gone. Like, I didn't know what to do anymore.
Do you feel like you had to mourn two people as well?
Yeah, I still am, really. It's like, I always think about my life. If she was still here, we knew we had our son and that. Tristan, we're going to call him. Tristan Matthew.
I just say, that's not part of their job.
I think everyone's on it. He's coming here to get his meth back.
At a community meeting in Tumut, Indigenous locals are sharing stories about how they've been treated at Tumut Hospital.
We go walk in there, walk on eggshells, right, and be really pleasant.
We try to do the right thing because every time we do the wrong thing, we get told.
I'm related to pretty well everyone in the community, so I have heard quite a few stories, some more tragic than others.
They just said, I'll go home, take this and take that tablets and everything else. The only reason she couldn't go home, she collapsed on the floor.
They felt that they weren't being listened to, that they were just being told to go away, or that they weren't being spoken to respectfully or even treated respectfully. Most people that our Aboriginal community deals with are terrific people. It is perhaps just a small number of people who immediately see that Aboriginal face and their treatment changes.
Just a few years before Naomi's death, local Indigenous woman Colleen Freeman was regularly presenting to Tumut Hospital with persistent and strong headaches. The feed has been told she received minimal treatment and was often sent home with nothing more than Panadol. She later died of a massive brain aneurysm. This is just one of the cases I found in this town with striking similarities. I've discovered the story of another young Indigenous woman, also called Naomi. Just a few months after that fateful New Year's Day, 37-year-old Naomi Ward turned up to Tumut Hospital, nauseous, dizzy, and vomiting. She was entering the final stages of life-threatening septicemia.
I just ran down the hall and I started screaming on the top of my lungs, help me, help me. It felt like someone was stabbing me.
After hours of excruciating pain, Naomi says the nurses at Tumut Hospital told her to pull herself together.
They said that I was just being pathetic and I had to stop being weak. I also tried to go to the toilet and she grabbed hold of my arm and she said, no, you're not going to the toilet to shoot up.
Naomi Ward does have a history of drug use, but at the time she fell sick, she says she had been clean for more than a decade.
I think they thought that I hadn't used drugs in a very long time and I'd slipped up and I'd had too much and that was it. I was going to sleep it off or something. My mum had called I don't know how many times and they told her the same thing, she's fine, she's fine. My mum said it would only been 20 minutes from that last phone call to the doctor saying, you need to come and say goodbye to your daughter, she's very sick and we're breathing for her. That was it.
Naomi was flown to Canberra with little hope that she would survive.
I was in a coma for 19 days. I went from life support in ICU for many months, then I went to dialysis for another lot of months. In that time, I had both legs removed. All my fingers and my arm was just hanging on by a thread. When I woke up, I was completely black. I was charcoaled. I had holes, like little worms had chewed through my legs. One big toe had snapped off. It was very painful, very, very painful. I had septicemia and apparently E. coli in my left lung.
With your sickness advancing as fast as it was any of this preventable?
I've been told by a doctor all I had to do was get an antibiotic drip and I had a 2-hour window period, but the nurses let it close.
Some people would say that maybe the nurses were under strain, maybe they lack training. Would that excuse the way that you were treated that night?
No, it would not. I begged for help. I begged for help for hours. I screamed, I cried, and I was just chucked back in the bed and told, shut up. They don't care. If you're not someone that's worth money or you're not someone that's white, you will get help, but you won't otherwise. It's not fair because this is how you end up. This is how you end up. Unfair, completely unfair. Sorry, I hate it. I didn't ask this to happen to me. I did nothing wrong. And now look, I can't even walk. I'm sorry.
Three Indigenous women, two dead and one severely disabled. The Aboriginal community says they received insufficient care because of racial discrimination. But how much of this was racism and how much just human error made within a struggling health system?
The nurses at small hospitals are often really amazingly skilled because they have to be.
Natalie Ellis cannot comment on the workings of Tumut Hospital or anything directly to do with the cases I'm investigating. But she does work at a hospital in the same area of a similar size.
There's such a broad range of what can walk in the door to a small rural place, and you have to be jack of all trades. It can be crazy and it can be a scary ride.
In regional areas, the doctors aren't always on site and nurses can be looking after up to 11 patients at once. That means just a few nurses are juggling the demands of the wider hospital as well as any emergencies that come through the door.
What's the protocol for deciding when to call in the doctor?
It's pretty clear protocols. You consult the doctor most of the time, unless it's something very simple.
Other states have laws requiring a ratio of one nurse to every four patients, but New South Wales does not. Something Nat says needs to change.
I believe it will save lives.
Look, in my experience, the staff here are highly trained. They're just generally good people trying to do a good job, and they've quite often got resourcing constraints.
John Larder is the deputy mayor and an ambulance paramedic in Tumut.
Local Aboriginal people in the town have told me that they have experienced racial discrimination here, particularly in the health system. Does that surprise you?
Look, nothing would surprise me. I mean, if they're saying it's happened, then, you know, I'm not to question that. I've always found that the hospital staff to be very mindful what we can do for Aboriginal communities.
But John says that hospitals don't always get it right.
Look, it's happened to white Australians as well. You know, like, people aren't always treated as you would hope they'd be treated, regardless of ethnicity or background.
I asked New South Wales Health to respond to local Indigenous people's claims of discrimination and inferior treatment experienced at Tumut Hospital. Instead, a representative from the Murrumbidgee Local Health District sent a statement saying an internal investigation had led to improvements in cultural awareness training and increased communication with the Aboriginal community. As a coronial inquest is underway, they couldn't comment further.
Look, I do think that Naomi's case could be a watershed for change in Australian medical history. I mean, the coroner has the power to make recommendations to improve public health, to ensure that deaths like this don't happen again.
The inquest into Naomi's death will deliver its findings next year, but what it won't answer is just how many other Indigenous Australians are treated this way.
In the shed is what Nay and I had together, like, this is practically our life together, just packed up until I can find a new house to live in that way. This box is a little one of memories of Nay. This is the last pea plate she had. This is a stray day hat for our fourth anniversary from Australia Day. This is the first little outfit he was going to wear, my son. So, he's the first thing we chose. We found out we were pregnant, so.
What are you holding on to them for in particular? Is it just?
Just memories, you know, like, just what I could have had, what I've lost, you know, like, just, I don't have much of him really, so.